Saudi Arabia, the world's biggest oil exporter, expects to ramp up its daily production by more than 1 million barrels by 2027. This means producing over 13 million barrels per day. The announcement comes a day after state-owned energy giant Aramco posted an 82% jump in first-quarter profits, buoyed by a global surge in oil prices stemming from the Ukraine war. The European Union foreign ministers failed to reach an agreement on a sixth package of sanctions against Russia. That package includes a controversial oil embargo, which Hungary is blocking because of its dependence on Russian oil. But Ukraine's foreign minister urges the EU to overcome Hungary's resistance, warning time is running out.
As long as Russia will be exporting its oil, gas, but also some other goods like iron ore, and other materials, it will have money to continue the war. To stop the Russian war machine, we need to deprive Putin of money. This is the only thing that he cares, power and money.
The Philippine government needs around 326 billion pesos in new revenues annually to pay the debts incurred during this pandemic. That's according to Albay 2nd District Representative Joy Salceda, who heads the lower house's tax writing panel. According to the House Ways and Means Chairman, the next administration must implement smart and efficient tax policies to address the debt overhang. He adds expanding fiscal space is needed to avoid incurring budget cuts or having to borrow again to pay the debt. The Philippine government's outstanding debt climbed to a new high in March to 12.68 trillion pesos as it tapped foreign and local lenders to bankroll the massive cost of its COVID-19 response. This resulted in the debt-to-GDP ratio ballooning to 63.5% in March, from less than 40% before the pandemic broke out. An elevated debt-to-GDP level could put the country's investment-grade credit ratings at risk, while also putting pressure on the government's narrower fiscal space amid the prolonged pandemic. Remittances for overseas Filipino workers improving for the first time since November last year as the global economy recovers from the effects of the pandemic. Warren De Guzman with the details.
Personal remittances from overseas Filipinos grew 3.1% year-on-year in March. That is the fastest growth rate for personal remittances since November and the first acceleration in remittance growth in the same time frame. The total for the month of $2.888 billion was below the record high total hit in December of $3.298 billion, but it wasn't far off. RCBC Chief Economist Michael Ricafort says remittances should improve further as more Filipino workers are deployed abroad in step with the steady reopening of the global economy from COVID-19 pandemic restrictions. He also believes they will increase their remittances to help their loved ones cope with rising inflation. Many former overseas Filipinos are in fact preparing to be redeployed abroad, ready to face off with the many familiar problems that come with working in a foreign country.
Okay naman po yung ano, minsan nga lang po ay may, yung amo talaga minsan nagbabago yung ugali, hindi po sa una talagang medyo stricto ganon, pero pag nagtagal-tagal naman medyo okay naman siya.
Socio-Economic Planning Secretary Carl Chua also noted recently that the redeployment of Filipinos abroad would be a big boost for the Philippine economy and its bid to graduate to upper middle income status from low middle income.
The computation of upper middle income is based on gross national income, which also includes our remittances from what do you call it?
Net primary income.
Okay. That has fallen significantly in the past 2 years because there are close to a million OFWs that were repatriated back. So they're not earning. That impacts our net primary income. So we have seen that the net primary income growth this quarter has grown by 100%. 103%. If that is sustained, meaning our OFWs, while we want them to stay and give them opportunity here, if they find opportunities abroad, that will help our GNI.
Ricafort, however, noted that the weakness of the Philippine peso against the U.S. dollar may offset these factors, as overseas Filipino workers would need to send back less dollars to fund the needs of their families, with the peso languishing at its weakest level against the greenback in 2.5 years. Warren De Guzman, ABS-CBN News.
The chief of the Philippine Economic Zone Authority warns of underground business process outsourcing firms that are luring employees from registered BPOs. PEZA Director General Charito Plaza told the House Ways and Means Committee on Monday that these unregistered IT BPO companies also offer higher pay for employees minus the security of tenure as a way to evade the government. Plaza believes another reason why workers opt for these underground establishments is so they can continue to work from home.
Nangyayari na po nga ngayon, nakikipag-agawan ang mga underground IT BPO o underground IT BPO sa mga employment or sa work. They are offering 30 to 40,000 pesos for the IT workers, Your Honor. So mas lalo tayong nalulugi doon kung hindi natin i-allow yung hybrid, no? At so lalong madagdagan yung mga underground na mga IT BPO who are not registered. So it's a loss to the government.
Despite PEZA's appeals, the Fiscal Incentives Review Board, an attached agency of the Finance Department, has stood pat on its order for BPOs to resume on-site operations or lose their tax incentives. The Anti-Red Tape Authority, or ARTA, welcomes President Rodrigo Duterte's order for government agencies to adopt digital payments. The president signed Executive Order 170, which mandates all government offices, local government units, and state universities to use digital disbursements in their transactions. It also covers financial assistance and payment of salaries, but it does not stop the acceptance of cash and other traditional modes of payment. ARTA says the use of digital payments will promote efficient delivery of government services, expedite transactions, boost revenue, and reduce the risk of graft and corruption.